Thank you, Professor Mitra, and our distinguished speakers for sharing those insights. The next panel is on South Asia and the emerging trends in West Asia. As Professor Mitra has implied, Dr. Iftikhar Ahmed Chowdhury, Principal Research Fellow at ISAS and former Foreign Minister of Bangladesh, will be chairing this session. To join Dr. Chowdhury, I would like to invite the panel's principal speaker, Ambassador Umej Singh Bhatia, and the following distinguished panelists: Mr. Shahid Javed Burki, Dr. Faramarz Tamanna, and Dr. Ayesha Siddiqa.
We will seamlessly move into the next panel. There will be four such panels which will cover the entire spectrum of ISAS's activities, and we will begin with the panel on South Asia and emerging trends in West Asia or the Middle East. We will look at phenomena developing in the Middle East and how South Asian countries, particularly Pakistan, Afghanistan, India, etc., dealing with relating to West Asia. And I shall begin with the principal speaker. We all have about 10 minutes to ourselves. So Ambassador Umej Singh Bhatia, who's Director General, Middle East, North Africa, and Central Asia Directorate, will lead discussions as the principal speaker. And over to you, Ambassador.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Chairman of ISAS, Ambassador Gopi Pele, chairperson of the panel, Dr. Iftikhar, my fellow panelists, Mr. Shahid, Dr. Faramarz, and Dr. Ayesha. It's a pleasure to and a privilege to be with you, and I'm very, very much going to say that I think my minister spoke very briefly and eloquently about the topic and substance of today's discussion. He raised three points, and Ambassador Tommy Koh, I'm also of that school, but I want to be a bit rebellious since my foreign minister is not here, so I'm not going to have the three-point schema. but I still hope to be brief. I'm going to talk first and foremost about a topic of our panel right now, which is the pivotal states next to South and West Asia. It's rather amorphous, so I hope to give it some structure to lead on to the far more knowledgeable panelists than I. First, the global context of where we are, and earlier my minister spoke a bit about this. The current global order is in doubt, and there's no doubt about that. The concerns exist about the future of a rules-based international system and maintaining effective structures of global cooperation. It's quite clear that disruption is the new norm, a permanent feature of our global landscape. In fact, we can talk today about global disconnectivity being as much of a reality as global connectivity, creating quite a complicated and contradictory landscape, one that's both hyper-connected and constantly disrupted. So when we look at this, we see three waves amplified by a fourth, three waves of disruption, background of a hyper-connected world. The first wave is the terror wave, the second is the political wave, the third is the economic wave, and all of this amplified by what my minister called the digital wave. The terror wave is quite obvious. We don't have to belabor the point. Non-state actors, Islamic State, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, who exploit open borders and hyper-connectivity to achieve their agenda. But they've stoked fears, and these waves are connected. They stoke fears in developed economies, deepening protectionist sentiments, generating a backlash against free trade flows and people-to-people links. And this leads on to the second wave, from the terror wave to the political wave. We see a growing anti-integration movement, a coarsening of rhetoric, exemplified by Brexit. Populism is resurgent, driving anti-globalization. There's no simple explanation for this, but in part it's generated by the inequalities created by unfettered global capital flows, which have now slowed sharply. The third wave is the economic wave. You have deglobalization along with anti-globalization, two different things. Flows across borders, as part of deglobalization, have been tightened to counter terror threats and refugee flows. Disrupting trade and people flows actually impedes economic development, and this vicious cycle creates a breeding ground of discontent, which is ripe for exploitation. So while trade and people flows slow, again, bear in mind this complicated and contradictory picture, internet traffic flows and tourism flows are still surging and provide opportunities both for economic growth and for challenges to security. So overall, if you look at this mixed picture, the challenges posed by the events of 2011, terror attacks, and 2008, the global financial crisis, and the response to more recent political developments, particularly political events in the West, have all reconfigured our global landscape. And we have a reshaped world that is uncertain, messy, and contradictory. And it adds to the sense of heightened vulnerability. Now, what does this mean for the nexus between West and South Asia, or South Asia's Western Front? You can choose to view that, South Asia's Western Front, as a crucible and a harbinger of our current global disarray, especially when you bear in mind the events of 2001. Viewed from a narrow prism, the so-called pivotal states of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and the surrounding states have had a collectively outsized impact on our global security. But let's also bear in mind that the cross-regional construct of West and South Asia and the idea of pivotal states are based on certain assumptions. Assumptions that perhaps require testing and questioning. South and West Asia are actually broad geographic terms of conceptual convenience. They describe a reality, perhaps, but hard to grasp. They illuminate as much as they obfuscate. The cross-regional connections may be viewed firstly through the lens of cultural commonalities, ethnic commonalities, or religion. You have the historical ties of the Silk Road, you have the Persian Mughal heritage, and you have religious and linguistic similarities. However, the cold reality is that the geopolitical environment of West and South Asia has been dominated by a security-related agenda, not so much one that focuses on culture. So it's a more of a hard view rather than a soft view. So less emphasis has been placed on building on the base of historical trade, cultural links to achieve economic development. Now, at the same time, despite the deep historical links, we should put this cultural commonalities in the proper perspective, and let's not overplay it. It's tempting to overemphasize the value of shared heritage, but we all know that ultimately it's very much it's prey to a selective shaping of history, a narrative that serves certain political and economic agendas. It's not neutral. So that's a note of caution. But at the same time, another note of caution is let's not try to take an overly one-dimensional, securitized perspective. We might want to view the region or that cross-regional, that Western Front, exclusively through this prism to address various security concerns. But is this approach really sustainable or productive? It could even be self-defeating in terms of promoting regional growth because of perceptions or discouraging investor confidence. For example, Pakistan's trade with Afghanistan, these two pivotal states, has dropped from 2.5 billion US in 2015 to 1.5 billion in 2016, largely due to security concerns holding back the renewal of the Afghanistan-Pakistan trade and transit agreement. That's when you view things through a one-dimensional securitized perspective. And recently, there was an interesting Wall Street Journal article on China's rail connectivity project with Afghanistan being hampered by one regional country's security concerns, worried about trains returning from Afghanistan, with terrorism-related smuggling. So it's appropriate to take a broader and more balanced perspective, one neither primarily security-based nor just merely underpinned by commonalities in culture, instead a mix between the hard and soft views that sees the cross-regional interface through the prism of collaboration and connectivity. Now, this is a sensible and obvious route to take and approach, collaborative regional economic development. If you look at Singapore's experience, my minister spoke earlier about our devotion to free trade. If you look at ASEAN, experience of ASEAN, I think this is cross-regional cooperation. Building connectivity, integrating markets can drive economic growth and prosperity and benefit the whole region. But clearly, it's easier said than done. And the political ecosystem has to be there. Institutions have to be there. But connectivity is still an important animating idea. whether of ports, energy pipelines, electricity grids, or telecoms networks, especially relevant for this region where you have inaccessibility because of geographic or security features. So how do you begin to start thinking about leveraging on the strategic locations along sea and land trade routes between these markets? You have China's One Belt, One Road initiative. You have the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. But it's also worth noting ASEAN, adopted as a model, as an example. And ASEAN is a region that's not naturally, as it were, there's no reason for ASEAN to be this coexist side by side quite so naturally. And it's important that it adopted a new master plan of connectivity 2025 last September to boost the region's infrastructure and logistics and connectivity. And all of this is to integrate a region of over 600 million people with a total GDP of over 2.3 trillion. So that's an idea, an animating idea that we can keep in mind. But of course, we need to identify in the pivotal states, not from a security perspective or cultural perspective, but a connectivity perspective, what are the pivotal cities or hubs that can help connect and bring growth? That can help generate growth and that can help do it in a sustainable way. You see, again, examples like Dubai or Singapore, models of pivotal cities in their respective regions, but very much dependent on trade. Is that relevant to South Asia's Western Front? Perhaps to a certain degree. We should also recognize that it'll take time if we're using the connectivity agenda to make progress. Incremental steps have to be taken, and this is not a big bang approach. Finally, it's actually worth noting that steps in this regard have already been made. If you look at connectivity, you have the Chabahar Agreement, you have the undersea pipeline between Iran and India, you have the Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Iran rail corridor, you have the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline. So you have some of these infrastructural initiatives already undertaken. But beyond foreign investment and these plans and development aid, from Singapore's perspective, some of these pivotal states require technical know-how and assistance to sustain their growth. And Singapore is doing its part. We have capacity building programs of Afghanistan, for example, developing the Afghan government's anti-corruption and governance expertise through courses under our Singapore Cooperation Program. And the philosophy here is not to give development assistance, but to essentially help with software and allow experts in these countries to stand up on their own. So we actually have trained more than 600 Afghan officials under the Singapore Cooperation Program. So it's about creating this mindset and help contributing to this mindset away from aid dependence. And I think there are a lot of positive stories because it's not just government that can contribute to economic development. We actually see individual entrepreneurs. And I was looking for more hopeful stories apart from the usual security mindset. And I was told an interesting story recently about an Afghan entrepreneur who moved to the US in the 80s after the situation in his country with the Russians' invasion. And he moved to Atlanta in the US, a gentleman called Habib Mohebi. And he was an entrepreneur there. He started a tailor shop. And one of his clients was an IBM programmer, computer programmer, a techie. And they had discussions over tea and started to tell this IBM programmer from the US about his country. And then they decided to do a business together, and they started doing logistics in Afghanistan. Over time, they had more discussions, and they realized that close to where he came from, in the Panjshir Valley, there was this wonderful resource in Afghanistan called the Panjshir Emeralds, which are very, very unique emeralds, green-blue, like the color of the eyes of some of the Afghans. And this Panjshir Emerald actually is something you can't get from anywhere else in the world. The decision was that they would both start a special mining company, and within a few years, they became one of the biggest exporters of these Panjshir gems, but they were not conflict gems. They were basically mined in a proper way, and now they've mined about 30,000 carats of these emeralds. So you actually have a positive story, And these emeralds are actually put on a global supply chain connectivity. They're brought from Tangier to New York, where you have the business headquarters of this company, and they're sent to North Dakota, where they're cut and then exported all over the world. So I think we can look at positive examples of this and start changing our mindset from just a one-dimensional securitized point of view. And it's also worth noting, and I'm happy to hear from Dr. Faramarz if he has more positive stories. You have example of startups in Afghanistan. You have a startup valley as well. The World Bank has done a tech incubator called Ibtikar with more than 20 tech startups. So let's try and see how we can go beyond the one-dimensional cultural or security-driven prisms to explore these three-dimensional living collaborative links on South Asia's Western Front, given this broader changing global context. We also perhaps can start thinking a little bit about how to implement the right structures and patterns of collaborative economic growth, linking hubs superimpose on the old regional trade route that crisscrossed the region, and start looking to have a new connective fabric, a positive one for the pivotal South and West Asian states, to hopefully, in a realistic and credible way, encourage people to deliver growth and stability. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Director General, for laying on the parameters of South Asia's relations with the Middle East. I'll very quickly move to the next speaker on my list, and it's a very well-known face and voice in Singapore, Mr. Shahid Javed Burki, who's a visiting senior research fellow at ISAS and also has been foreign finance minister of Pakistan. Mr. Burki.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I guess 24 minutes divided by three means about 8 minutes each. Right. I just want to make a couple of points and do them quickly. One, that the world is faced with some enormously significant, difficult challenges. And second, that I don't think we are equipped, at least in South Asia, to be able to deal with them. So let me just expand on these two observations. The first one is the election of Mr. Donald Trump as the US president. It is based on some assumptions which happen to be incorrect. Trump has risen to the top of the political system because of the mobilization of enormous amount of anger there is in the United States and also to a certain extent in Britain about what people perceive is a damage done to them, done to their livelihood by the process of globalization. Now, he was able to sell that message after meeting with lots and lots of people, very angry people, but the message is that we want jobs back in the United States. This is a total misunderstanding of what's going on. What's going on is that the US labor force, which is about 140 million, has lost about 20 million jobs in gross terms. And that has happened not because China and Mexico have taken away the jobs, that has happened because technology has advanced, and robots and other technological innovations have come in, and they have taken away jobs that could be performed easily by machines and technology. Now, for him to say, for Donald Trump to say that I want to bring jobs back, he's not going to be able to do it, because this is built into the way Western economies are developing. So there will be a reaction once his supporters begin to see that he's not been able to deliver what he promised. But that notwithstanding, the damage to the institutional structure would have been done. In 70 years, a new international economic order was built, It was based on rule-based finance, rule-based capital flows, rule-based trade. And that's being attacked by the United States and perhaps also by Britain to a certain extent. So what we are going to see is an enormous pressure now to come up with systems that are not universal systems, not rule-based systems, but systems that are going to be focused much more on individual country interests. The United States has already withdrawn from TPP. It has indicated that it is not going to observe a number of other rule-based things that are guiding global commerce, global capital flows, and so on and so forth. US may become much more of an isolated economy than was the case before. So this is going to be damaging. And what we are going to see, and that's where I'm worried about the South Asian situation, is much greater focus on regionalism rather than globalism. And South Asia, as some other people have commented already, is ill-equipped in terms of working as a region rather than working as a bunch of individual countries, and that's unfortunate. The second thing I'd like to focus on is the previous panel talked about ocean-based political system in South Asia. What we are seeing now, and I don't think it has been fully appreciated by what the Chinese are doing. Chinese have decided to go in for what I call land-based commerce. I remember having a conversation many, many years ago with the Prime Minister of China, and he took me to his office and he pointed to a map that was on the wall back to his at the back of his desk. And he said to me, isn't it interesting that we are the only large landmass country that is landlocked on three sides? We are open only on one side, the eastern side. And he said to me, we want to break out of this isolation by building corridors that would take us into West Asia, Europe, the Indian Ocean, and so on. And he said, for us, Pakistan is critical. Unfortunately, and this is about 25 years ago, this conversation, he said, unfortunately, Pakistan is not responding. And if you know anybody senior in Pakistan, can you relate this conversation to this senior person? Which I did, but it took Pakistan something like 20 years to wake up to the fact of enormous Chinese interest in land-based commerce. Now, what I see happening in our part of the world is that the Chinese investing something like $1 trillion over a period of 10 to 15 years are going to build new routes, are going to exploit enormous amount of mineral wealth that exists in Central Asia. There was a study done by Pentagon a few years ago. They estimated that Afghanistan is sitting on top of $1 trillion worth of minerals, which the Chinese need desperately for their economic progress. All that, and then obviously the countries of Central Asia have enormous energy riches and so on. All this is going to be exploited by the Chinese, and all of it will be carried by road rather than by sea. In the last couple of years, I've become a member of something called the Astana Club. This is, again, a Chinese-sponsored think tank located in Astana, the capital of Kazakhstan. And I made a presentation over there on what I'm saying over here, importance of land-based commerce. And there was a Japanese delegation, and the head of that delegation turned to me and he said, Mr. Burki, that's bad economics, because commerce is sea-based commerce, not land-based commerce. So I said to him, whatever his name was, addressed him by his name, and I said, you know, what you're saying is not correct. I live in a country, the United States, which is surrounded by sea, but 86% of all that the Americans consume is transported by land, not by sea. So what we are going to see is the development very fast of land-based commerce that will have enormous implications for South Asia. And I think it would be to the advantage of South Asian nations to come together and become part of this development rather than be either indifferent to it or in some cases oppose this kind of effort that Beijing is making. So essentially what I'd like to conclude by saying that the enormous change that we are now living through insofar as global politics and economics is concerned is something that should be a matter of great interest to the countries in South Asia, and they should work together rather than against each other to make use of the opportunities that are now on offer. And I hope this particular group and ISAS and so on and so forth would take up this challenge and develop ideas, thinking that would place us in a better position rather than hurt us as a result of global change. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Burki, for bringing these new ideas, etc., to the table, introducing us to the Astana Club and the new forming concepts and ideas that South Asia will need to address itself to. Moving on to the next speaker on my list, Dr. Faramarz Tamanna. We are very glad that you are here. Dr. Tamanna is the Director of Center for Strategic Studies and Chancellor of the Afghanistan Institute of Higher Education. You have the floor, sir.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It's my pleasure here among the scholars of South Asian countries and other countries. And thank you, His Excellency Ambassador Gopinath Pillai, for inviting me to this conference. And His Excellency Chairperson, scholars, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum and good morning. I think for today's campus of the panel, I'm the right person, or at least can claim that I'm the right person that my panelists and discussants to speak about Southwest Asian trends and the mutual influence of these two regions on each other. This self-confidence has been transformed to me by the privilege of being as a citizen of a country which is located at the margins of both regions. We are at the heart of Asia. People ask us, are you Central Asian? Are you West Asian? Are you South Asian or East Asian? And our answer is all and none of the above. We are the hub of connectivity between these four parts of Asia. Arnold Toynbee-Wiz, the British historian, had two terms, a roundabout and a cul-de-sac. A roundabout is a place where all ideas flow into and flow out of. A cul-de-sac is a place where an idea comes and gets stuck. It cannot leave. Afghanistan throughout the ages has been the roundabout. So, as a fact, located as we are in the heart of Asia, we in Afghanistan register and are affected by the moment, by the movements and turmoils of all parts of Asia. Dear friends, with focus on today's discussion, I have to say that Afghanistan is hardly located in the framework of South Asia or West Asia. Frederick Starr has done this fantastic book. It is called The Last Enlightenment. Based on his research, we can say that the best roads of connectivity between different parts of Asia go through Central Asia and Afghanistan. So our location for 200 years has been a course, and in this century, I think, will be one of our most significant advantages. I'm personally belonging to the Western Asia side of Afghanistan. There, let me share some of the live experiences of work I have observed to mutual interactions between the ongoing different issues and both regions. Before going into some factual issues of Southwest Asia, let me give my objective framework to at least define a scholarly path to the later part of my speech. I believe that four accepted facts should be taken into consideration when talking inter-regional mutual trends. First, that no neighboring regions are separated from each other's dynamism. Second, that Southwest Asia is the most interlinked region of the world. Third, that the powers in both the regions defined their sphere of influence into the realm of each other's region. And fourth, that Afghanistan is the pivotal state in southwest of Asia. No doubt, any positive and negative politics in both the region have strongly their influence and effect in Afghanistan. Let me give you the most updated and relevant example, terrorism. Ladies and gentlemen, we all better know that terrorism is an independent variable which has been used by the state actors to achieve certain goals. The prevailing terrorist activities in Afghanistan is enrooted in the region surround my country. The Kashmir nightmare, and Arabs' theological clashes are the two main sources of the terrorist organizations. Talibanization of Afghanistan began from South Asia, and the current Daeshification of my country is from Western Asian trends. Esteemed scholars, as you all know, Asian continental economy is in the process of emerging. The energy resources of the Caspian Basin and Central Asia, esteemed at 600 trillion cubic meters of gas, tens of thousands of megawatts of electricity, will power South Asia. Looking at Afghanistan as a fulcrum point within a regional network, to the north, there are pipelines that extend deep into Central Asia, to the west in access to oil and employment. To the south, we can extend transport and improve transit. Seeing Asia as a single region opens up entire horizon for rethinking our strategies for growth and development. Our potential is to become the land bridge and the roundabout of South and West Asian cooperation. And such scenario, with focus on Afghanistan's place in China's connectivity with South and West Asia, which is my specific topic, is an important factor here to concentrate on some of the potential possibilities. Touching on China foreign policy, in South Asia's West Front countries, three important perspectives cannot be ignored. One, as a route for China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, CPEC, and Belt and Road Initiative, BRI. Second, as potential source of insecurity for having terrorism and separatism. Third, as instrumental stage and ground to balance our regional and beyond regional stakeholders. As route for economic corridors, I must add that if we have a glance to the history of China foreign policy or economic perception during Communist Party, it has been moving from risk-averse caution to optimistic dreaming about a better world in which China has recovered its place. Whereas 20 years ago, China used to keep saying no, or at best, maybe, to the international communities. Now it wants to say yes. And Portmore suggests the biggest initiative to world trade and transit and convincing the states to join and collaborate with the Belt and Road Initiative. The Chinese semi-martial plan, which can create demand and more contrast for Chinese enterprise in the major projects of infrastructure and construction, would literally, figuratively pave the ways for Chinese goods and service to enter in the new markets. With this intention, beyond other routes, there are two important initiatives in western part of South Asian countries. First is China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, and the second is Belt and Road Initiative, which touch Central Asia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iran. The tremendous capital, which is about $1 trillion US dollar, made China as important game changer in rising Asia and consequently made South Asia's West Front vital in China foreign policy. For achieving a stable region, China indirectly trying to mediate between state and non-state actors for two reasons. First, to not being targeted by radical sector actors. Second, use its positive role to reduce the level of tension. India, as an important stakeholder, due to the border conflict, especially in Kashmir disputes, and strategic competition reaching Central Asia, Central Asian sources, is not happy with China's regional economic initiatives. Additionally, US has shown its concerns about non-peaceful rising of China in international arena. So China saves Pakistan and Iran for initiatives in one hand and figuratively balances US and India in the other hand. So South Asia's West Front as a strategic and vital area for China's dream can't be ignored as instrumental stage and ground to flourish concept of rising Asia and balance other regional and beyond regional stakeholders. This perception can be well perceived through transition of power in global stage, which had increased the sensitiveness of the regional cooperation. Any regional economic and security cooperation can be easily translated as source of mistrust with beyond regional stakeholders. In other words, global tolerance due to the new security and economic establishment is reduced. It seems China regional economic improvement needs a new chapter of China-US cooperation. So far, I am representing Afghanistan. I would like to talk about Afghanistan as an important stage between China and United States cooperation. China needs a stable region, and US seeks Afghanistan to be integrated with regional cooperation routes to maintain security. It means there is a common goal between the US and China, and Afghanistan can be a good stage for cooperation and interaction. Finally, I will conclude with this idea that Afghanistan has the potential to become the uniting ground for Asia's continental transformation. We are 8 hours by road from Delhi. We are 6 hours by plane from Beijing. Every single one of our neighbors we can reach within 3 hours of flight or 25 hours of drive. We are in the middle of more than 3 billion people, which most of them are living in India and China. Our bilateral cooperation with Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, India, China, Turkey, Iran, and Gulf countries in this area has been well established. Now, our key goal is to become a regional transit hub and hopefully will very quickly be realized. The review of Afghanistan's role for promoting Southwest Asian cooperation offers two key messages. First, Afghans are moving together with their neighbors in Southeast, Central, and West Asia from an emphasis on planning for and negotiating joint infrastructure and commercial deals to witnessing tangible progress on new investment, construction, and trade opportunities. And second, from the Lapis Lazuli corridor through Turkmenistan, the Caucasus, Turkey, and onward to Europe, to Chabahar port in Iran, a new rail connection with China and emerging transport corridor opportunities with Pakistan and all of the Central Asian Republic, the Silk Road through Afghanistan is being built, establishing modern trade, transit, energy, and communications links at the crossroads of Central, South, and Southeast Asia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chancellor Tamanna. No country, no society has paid a higher price for its strategic location as Afghanistan has, but you also point to the tremendous opportunities that also opposes Afghanistan and that you're poised to take advantage of those. Move on to Dr. Ayesha Siddiqa, Research Associate, SOAS, University of London, not a stranger in Singapore. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chaudhary. Extremely grateful to ISAS and to Professor Mitra for inviting me. Let me be a bit of a spoiler. I mean, I've been listening to what the earlier panelists said. Ambassador Bhatia talked about startups in Afghanistan and how things would change. Mr. Burki spoke about the great potential that the region has. Yet nobody has spoken about the challenges and one of the primary challenges, especially in connection with West Asia, and that pertains to the growing threat of terrorism and radicalism in the region. Yes, we have CPEC. Yes, we have One Belt, One Road. We have other opportunities opening up. Yet, there is growing poverty. There is growing political disconnectivity in the region, which is a huge challenge in itself. But let me quickly turn to South Asia's connection with West Asia. Historically, we are tied in a primordial identity with the Middle East. That has been primary, and indeed, it played a major role in bringing Muslims of South Asia together with Muslims of the Arabs of West Asia, especially during the 1980s. It was a critical moment, not just in in terms of fighting a war and winning a war, but also in transforming South Asian Islam to something very different. 1980s is primarily when it happened, when a whole transformation, the South Asian Islam, which was essentially of a Central Asian character, a major shift happened then, and that clock, we could never turn it back. And now if we look at the Middle East, there are a lot of things which are happening, a lot of challenges which are emerging there. For example, there is a sectarian war that's going on. The way Middle Eastern issues are being sorted out and handled, it is going to increase, it's going to definitely increase sectarian violence there. It's already, we find it there. The other thing which is happening in the Middle East is a gradual meltdown of some of the states, and also reduced economic capacity of many of the countries, including Saudi Arabia. What does that mean is people perhaps from South Asia, resident diaspora, returning back to their homelands, bringing back some of the some of the ideology. It's a package deal. And so sectarianism knocks on our door, as does ISIS. Some of the experts have talked about once ISIS packs up in the Middle East, it's probably yesterday that the leader of ISIS, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, talked about non-Arabs striking terror at home since they couldn't achieve their objective in Iraq. Now, it's interesting that nobody wants to really look at the growing radicalism in South Asia. It's in a way connected with West Asia, but also independent of West Asia. That radicalism has its base in how politics has and social politics has grown in our own region. Our terror is very home-based. It may have its strength, its ideological strength as elsewhere, but it's very home-based. And in the morning, the foreign minister talked about the middle class being a source of strength. I would kind of like to draw his attention, I wish he was here, that the problem with the South Asian middle class is that it is also a source today of radicalism. I mean, be it India, or be it Bangladesh, or be it Pakistan, or be it Afghanistan. Well, Afghanistan, I would say, is a bit different. The Afghan middle class is taking a different course. But in the rest of the countries, including Bangladesh, including Maldives, the middle class is underwriting radicalism in a big way. It's not the poor man's battle. It's actually the middle class man's battle, which is being fought. That's a big issue. Now, of course, all of this happening is happening in the backdrop of some structural developments taking place, for example, CPEC. And the problem there is, CPEC, of course, is an opportunity, but it's a bit of a problem as well. I'm talking about, when I say CPEC, it's China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. And the One Belt, One Road theme. Now, while it offers opportunities, it offers certain challenges as well. And one of the things is that these projects are coming to these countries with vulnerable political governments. That's a huge vulnerability, and there is no dialogue within these societies about implementation of these projects, which would result in a relative weakening. China, we know, has a future in South Asia, and it's playing a major role. Yet, one of the issues on which it does not seem to play a role pertains to radicalism and terrorism. Now, I'm told that China is not assertive. It does not want to twist arms like United States. It does not want to push countries to adopt certain options. Yet, we also look at China as the force which can perhaps encourage some of its partner states to deviate from a good versus Taliban, bad Taliban policy. However, I do not see Beijing doing that, embarking upon that. And in fact, if you look at South Asia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, what I see are two, I have two observations to make, and which is my final point. First is that I see non-state actors as stakeholders in not just the conflict, but development in South Asia. They continue to play a role. While one state may take responsibility, there are others which will be which will benefit. In fact, non-state actors could be used as pawns in a competition between different stakeholders, state actors, stakeholders, especially in Afghanistan, in negotiating possibilities in and around Pakistan and Afghanistan. So that's first observation. The other is that because of this factor and others, there is going to be a lot of turmoil in Afghanistan and greater contestation between India and Pakistan. I mean, while opportunities knock on South Asia's doors, one of the major issues is that I do not see the cloud of hostility dissipating. The India-Pakistan rivalry will remain primary. And in fact, what is added on to it is the Afghanistan-Pakistan rivalry. So probably in the short to medium term, we are going to see more violence. Now, how do you help these states, South Asian states, to renegotiate their relationship? And the question is China, will China play its role to help them renegotiate relationship? I mean, these are big questions to which one does not have an answer anymore right now. Thank you.
Thank you. You're very right to say that there could be problems without solutions as well. Anyway, now we are at an equilibrium. I mean, we have physical hunger competing with intellectual hunger. So we will nevertheless have a quick Q&A, perhaps if the organizers allow for it, 15 minutes of it. We will begin with, the questions will have to be brief and also those that the questioner would want answers in brief as well. So Anisha, I'll recognize you. I'll give you the floor, but all of you would need to sort of identify yourself for our record.
Hello.
Identify yourself and speak.
Yes, my name is Anish Mishra. I'll speak a bit fast. Okay, I want to speak on some of the things that Pakistan has done for Afghanistan. Firstly is that today there are 3 million Afghan refugees in Pakistan. And then Pakistan has also provided 3,000 scholarships for Afghan students. And this is for a country of which their own children has been deprived of education. They are giving scholarships to Afghan students. Of course, this is to match India. And recently, the Afghan president, Ashraf Ghani, has rejected $500 million from Afghan. The thing is that, and also because of Afghan's relation with India, we spoke about, you know, about having a good Taliban, bad Taliban policy, but we forget that Afghanistan itself has a good Taliban and bad Taliban policy because it supports the TTP, the Tariq-e-Taliban, which actually it's responsible for most of the terrorism that has taken place in Pakistan. And this provides a need because, you see, after Operation Zarbe Erbs, I'm coming to it. Okay, after Operation Zarbe Erbs, we see that terrorism in Pakistan is almost cleared, and now the terrorists are then in Afghanistan. This provides a need to actually have a military operation in Afghanistan if you want to clear if you want to clear terrorism in Pakistan. But there's a risk of it, and the risk of it is that if Pakistan actually conducts a military operation in Afghanistan, then there may be a backlash from in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Just a second, my second point is even shorter. Please allow me to make this point. This panel actually discussed about regional connectivity. One point I want to make is that if we look at the reason of existence of Afghanistan actually, it's neither a nation nor a state. The only reason why Afghanistan exists is actually to be a buffer zone between the great powers. And when it comes to regional connectivity, I'm very pleased with the points that Dr. Tamanna made on regional connectivity on Afghanistan. It's very interesting to know that Afghanistan has an interest in regional connectivity, because what I feel is that Afghanistan
Anish, over lunch perhaps, but now I think I'll have to ask you.
Two words. Right. In fact, I would say Afghanistan actually is a hindrance to regional connectivity between South Asia and Central Asia. Thank you very much.
The response from the panel. Thank you, David Malone, Undersecretary General, UN, Rector, University, UN University, Tokyo. David?
Thank you very much, Ifti. My question is for Umej, and it's delightful to see you back in your country after devoting so many years to the Gulf region. And you spoke about it, I think, with great feeling, positive feeling. And in a way, Dubai is a tribute to Singapore with Gulf characteristics. However, how does one induce the Middle East to look at the rest of the world rather than focusing on its own problems? I do think ASEAN has a lot to offer the rest of the world as an example of how to overcome conflict. But the desire needs to be there to begin with.
Okay, one more question perhaps, and then I'll go back to the, at the end of the room, yes. Identify yourself and speak. Do you have a microphone?
This is Sridhar Bokaji from Blossom Group. My question is on one of the last things that you have written, the security. Do you think there is a different impact with the new change of president in US with Donald Trump coming in with other nations and including Asia? That means the dynamics here on the global politics.
Are you addressing this to any particular panelist?
Dr. Chaudhary, yourself, you want to answer?
Excellent. Jolly good. Okay, we will, Davran question, and then Ambassador, and then I'll wrap up.
Is it working?
Yeah, it works.
Very quickly, the question on Afghanistan and Pakistan. You see, I didn't, when I talked about good Taliban versus bad Taliban, it wasn't just reference to Pakistan. It's whoever engages in it, and in that case, both countries, Afghanistan and Pakistan, have their good and bad. But, you know, your question about, I mean, you were trying to make comments and ask a lot of questions. I don't think that either Afghanistan or Pakistan are currently engaged in cleaning up their own house. Both need to do that. Zarb-e-Azab doesn't mean anything. What Zarb-e-Azab meant was cleaning some while keeping some other actors. So be very clear on that. There are sources which are internal to the country, sources of terrorism, which are still being kept. So that is an issue. Afghanistan, again, I wouldn't, you know, agree with your statement that it's mainly merely a buffer zone. I think there has been a transformation in its character in the past couple of decades. For whatever that investment in Afghanistan has meant or is worth, I think what is new about Afghanistan is that there is a middle class emerging, there is a new state which is under formation. And it wants to belong, it wants to have ownership of the state. And in fact, if you watch the dialogue between Afghanistan and Pakistan, what this Afghan government keeps telling its neighbors, definitely Pakistan, is that, look, we belong. We have a state and allow us its ownership. So, you know, there is this conversation happening, and I would not say that it's no longer a state with a right to exist. However, the question is, how will these neighbors negotiate peace with each other, which brings larger stability? That is something which would require help from external actors, internal actors, regional actors. And it's a big question mark on who is going to carry the flag and help carry out this dialogue.
Thank you. Would you like to say anything quickly? Yes.
With focus on Afghanistan, we don't have any bad or good Talib in our country. About the Pakistani battle against the terrorist attacks in the territory of Afghanistan, surely, definitely, certainly, nobody are allowed to make operation in our territory, in any aims, because in our Afghanistan foreign policy, nobody is allowed to threaten Afghanistan from their territory, and also no groups in Afghanistan are allowed to threaten our neighboring countries. The other parties, we are seeking for security-based, economic-based security community, as Carl Deutsch say, a security community, but we Afghanized the Carl Deutsch's theory that changed it to economic-based security community. And we transferred the security trends with our neighboring countries to the economic trends. And we hope that the economy will enhance our cooperation with all other neighboring countries in the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you very much. Dr. David Malone, you ask a very important question, which I think actually has resonance for the issue, if you take it from a different perspective of South Asia's West Asian front. And you mentioned Dubai, because Dubai is really a city in West Asia with a large South Asian facing focus. And it also plays a key part in terms of creating the connectivity for the region. The Middle East per se, I mean, I think it's really a mosaic. But if you look at the GCC, and you mentioned ASEAN, the GCC has reached out to ASEAN. As early as 1990, the Foreign Minister of Oman reached out to ASEAN to say, let's have a cross-regional linkage. And this basically took form, and we've had two GCC-ASEAN foreign ministerial meetings already. Bahrain is now one of the key prime movers in the GCC side. And in ASEAN, we have Singapore as well, that's fairly active. And I think you have that cross-regional linkage and that structure. You have Dubai. You have GCC sovereign wealth funds, which are scouring the world for healthy returns and for structuring stronger and sustainable economic relations. So I think there's quite a bit. But again, it's about sitting back and reframing our perspectives. You actually also have lots of Afghan businessmen who might not want to meet in Afghanistan but go to Dubai to do business deals for various reasons. So there is that, you can widen your perspective and look at Dubai precisely as being part of South Asia's West Asian front, and it's open, connected, and forward-looking. Thank you.
Thank you. I also had a question directed at me, since I was not a speaker at this panel, I'll abide by the principle that speech is given to the diplomat to conceal his thoughts. Nonetheless, we have a very senior American diplomat scholar who's going to speak to us, will be a principal speaker, Ambassador George Moose. I'm sure he'll cover this and many other points besides. We have had a very, very stimulating discussion. I will close the panel, but not the conversation. That will continue. It'll continue through lunch, and I will invite you to it. And before I do that, I would like to thank each and every panelist for very important contribution that each and every panelist had made to our session. Thank you very much, and thank you too. Bye.